Some people say it's not Sahih, Sahih, not Sahih. You know, when you ask them, what is the meaning of Sahih? Well, Sahih is the opposite of Ghalat. You know the meaning of Sahih. And how are you telling us that it's not Sahih? Sahih is a terminology. It's not that Urdu or Arabic Sahih Ghalat. Sahih is a terminology. Hadith is of various types. Sahih li dhatihi, Sahih li ghayrihi, Hasan li dhatihi, Hasan li ghayrihi, and then Zaif, and then Munkar, and then other Mawzu. So the Mawzu means fabricated, wrong. Munkar means there is some dodginess in there. And Zaif means there is no weakness in the chain. And then, if there are plenty of Zaif Ahadith, they rise to the rank of Hasan. Sometimes Hasan li ghayrihi, sometimes Hasan li dhatihi. And if there is Hasan li dhatihi Hadith, many, then they can rise to the rank of Sahih li ghayrihi. And many Sahih li ghayrihi, they can rise to the rank of Sahih li dhatihi. So these are terminologies of Muhaddithin. And the Muhaddithin have said that for istidlal and dalil in jurisdiction and fiqhi masail, any of the four categories, first four categories can be enough. Sahih li dhatihi, Sahih li ghayrihi, Hasan li dhatihi, Hasan li ghayrihi. You can use any of those four for istidlal of fiqhi ahkam. Even if you come a little bit down to the Zaif rank as well, many times you can use Zaif hadith for fiqhi masail as well. And our fuqaha have done that, used even the Zaif hadith for fiqhi masail as well. And we can give many examples for that. Like the mas'ala of al-qahqaha fi salat, a person laughing loudly in salah. That is the hadith. That once some sahabi came who had a little bit blurred vision, and in those days there were no spectacles, so his vision was a bit blurred. He came for salah, jamaat was taking place, and on one side there was a slight ditch inside the masjid because there was no carpet in the masjid. The masjid Nabawi Sharif was same as outside. There was soil. Only difference was outside there were sharp stones, and inside Masjid Nabawi there was soft sand. That is the only difference. There were no carpets, no musallas, no sajjadas inside Masjid Nabawi. Simple masjid. So there was a little bit of ditch in one area, and the sahabi, because he could not see properly, he came to join the congregation jamaat, and he somehow tripped and he fell. So those sahabas who saw him, they started laughing, because naturally when someone falls or slips, you start laughing. So they laughed aloud. So after salah, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam turned around and he said, "Who laughed aloud, loudly?" And they said, "Ya Rasulullah, sorry, it was our mistake. Go back, do your wuzu and repeat your salah." So they had to go back, repeat their wuzu and repeat the salah. Now, based on this hadith, Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi said, when he mentions the nawaqif of wuzu, what breaks wuzu? That you say passing wind, urine, stool, blood coming out, vomit, pass. And he will say, also qahqaha fi salat. Laughing loudly in salah will break your salah, nullify the salah. Now this hadith is za'if. But fuqaha said, even though the chain of this narration might be za'if, that hadith might not be in Sahih Bukhari or Sahih Muslim, even though it's the weakness in narration, but we have to take it into consideration. And because Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that go and do your wuzu again, so if someone smiles in salah, there's no problem, his salah will not break. But if someone laughs loudly to the extent that the person standing next to him can hear his laughter, then his wuzu will also break. He will have to repeat his wuzu and then repeat his salah. Not only will his salah break, his salah is broken, but his wuzu is also broken. So this is a weak hadith. But the fuqaha take masail from there. Many hadiths like this. For example, la wasiyyata li warithin. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, there is no wasiyyat for a warith. Let's say my son Muhammad Safwan sitting over there. Now if I die, and before I die I make a wasiyyat that from my money give my son Safwan £5,000. I can't do that because he's already going to inherit. He's already going to get his share of my monies, whatever I leave behind. Don't think that I've got so much money. But I'm just telling you that if, for example, if someone says that, then you can't do wasiyat for him. Now, la wasiyat al-liwarith is a zaif hadith. But all four a'immah arba'a say that you have to practice on this hadith, and you can't set a will for a person who is already inheriting you. Now, I'm trying to say that you can use daif hadith for masail and ahkam as well. This is why the jurists, the fuqaha, they were more closer to the era of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi is the closest. He was born in the year 80. Imam Malik was born in the year 94. Imam Shafi was born in the year 150. Imam Ahmad was born in the year 164 after Hijrah. So you realize, this is why Imam Abu Hanifa is called Imam A'zam. Because among these four Imams, he is the closest and he is the greatest, and his followers are the most in number throughout the world. That's why he's called Al-Imam Al-A'zam. It's not Al-Imam Al-A'zam compared to Rasulullah. And some people will say, oh, Imam Al-A'zam is Rasulullah, and why do you call Abu Hanifa Imam Al-A'zam is shirk? Tawbah, tawbah, astaghfirullah. But Imam Azam in comparison to Malik, Shafi and Ahmad, not in comparison to Rasulullah. Who is Imam Abu Hanifa in front of Rasulullah? Rasulullah is Rasulullah, he's only a wali of Allah. He's an alim, he's a faqih, he's a jurist, he's a mujtahid. That's all. He's not Rasulullah. He doesn't get divine inspiration and wahi of Quran from Allah. He only researches and he puts his research in front of the Ummah. And the Ummah accepted and liked his research. So, Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Shafi, Imam Malik, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, they worked really hard and they were more closer to the era of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we see that now we are 1400 years away and we try to compete with them. Could that be possible? They knew Rasulullah more, they knew Sahaba and Tabi'een more than us. We only take textual evidence and then we come forward and say, oh, this is daif, this is mawzu. They knew the masail better than us. And that is why they must sometimes use daif hadith as well for ahkam and masail. This is using daif hadith for masail. Now, using daif hadith for the two subjects, masail and fazail. Now, for the fazail, you can use daif hadith without any question. There is nearly consensus of the ummah on this subject. You take it from day one, when the science of hadith was developed and the muhaddithin start talking about hadith and the science of hadith. The earliest muhaddithin like Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Abdul Rahman ibn Mahdi, Yahya ibn Ma'in, and all those great, great legends of those who were the teachers of Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi, they all said that you can use daif hadith in fazail. Even Imam Bukhari rahmatullah said you can't use daif hadith in fazail. Shall I give you the evidence for that? Imam Bukhari has written many books, over 30 books. His most famous work is Sahih al-Bukhari. He had a vision that in this book, he only wants to include such and such ahadith which are of this particular category, which reach the highest rank of Sahih. So he brought no other ahadith in that book. He wrote another book called Al-Adab al-Mufrad. Now, he didn't hold that vision in this book. And he didn't want to include just Sahih ahadith in there. He included in there hadith, Hasan ahadith and Zaif ahadith as well in that book. There will be many, many ahadith. Imam Bukhari himself knows that this hadith is weak in regards to chain of narration. But he has included that book, that hadith in his Al-Adab al-Mufrad. Which shows that even Imam Bukhari rahmatullah says that daif hadith can be used for fazail. Mm-hmm.